Nurses and doctors share their weirdest slash scariest stories that took place during work. Don't forget to like and subscribe to support us. This is a story that was told to me by a nurse who worked in a nursing home in a small Texas town. Now, in this nursing home, there were two wings that were connected by a hallway. Compared to the front wing, the back was always a bit heavy with gloom, maybe even spooky at times. I'm not sure how to explain it, but there was certainly a darker atmosphere. For this reason, the nurses disliked staying in the back, so after the residents were in bed and the night's last rounds were completed, they would migrate to the front nurses' station. This nightly trek went on for a while, until the administration learned of it and, for liability reasons, instructed the back wing nurses to stay in their assigned place of duty. There were always ghostly happenings. Nonetheless, these incidents were mostly shrugged off as the imagination of tired and overworked employees. But there was one incident in particular that was quite terrifying and was witnessed by several people. One resident, Mr. Gomez, was rumored to have been into brujería, the Spanish word for witchcraft, throughout his life. Late at night, Mr. Gomez, according to reports from other residents, would creep into their rooms like a serpent born of hell. He would slither on his stomach, his arms at his sides. His eyes would be rolled back in his head, his tongue darting in and out of his mouth, flicking the air like a human snake. He would crawl under their beds and try to push them off. "He's the devil," the other residents would claim. Well, the reports weren't taken very seriously. After all, these old folks were half out of their minds, and realistically, how could feeble old Mr. Gomez, who needed the assistance of nurses just to get out of bed, be physically capable for such actions? The nurses all agreed that the reports were just imagined stories of old, confused people. That is, until the terrifying night that the nurses all became believers in the evil that lived within Mr. Gomez. It was well past midnight, the residents were sleeping, and the halls were quiet. The nurses had gathered in the back lobby to sit and wait for morning. Most of them were at the point of dozing off when a loud gasp broke the silence. One of the nurses stood up with a frightful expression on her face. She pointed down the hall towards the residents' rooms. As the others turned to look, a horrifying scene unfolded. It was Mr. Gomez, slithering on his stomach, making his way down the hall and into the room of a slumbering woman. They just stood there, petrified, unsure of what to do. Mr. Gomez was now crawling through the hallway, heading right towards the lobby, and the fear-struck nurses. The stories were true. Mr. Gomez was slithering like a snake, his eyes rolling back and his tongue flicking in and out like a cursed beast. They watched as he snaked through the lobby furniture, crawling between chair legs and hissing at the shocked women. The nurses all ran up the hallway to the front desk. The doors to the back wing slammed shut as the last one passed through. They stayed up front for the next few hours. And as the sun began to peek over the horizon, they gathered enough courage to go check on the back wing. Everything was quiet, and Mr. Gomez was once again sleeping in his bed. A few nights later, Mr. Gomez passed away. As the nurses were attending to his body, several loud thumps were heard against the window. They pulled open the drapes to see what could have made the noise. And just as they did, a lechuza, Spanish word for owl, flew at the window, clawing at the pane as if trying to get in. The bird then flew into a nearby tree and landed among several other lechuzas perched high in the branches. The birds just stared down at the room where Mr. Gomez lay dead, waiting to claim his soul. I'm actually a unit clerk and didn't experience this personally, but anyway. I used to work on the burn unit. One night that I was working, one of the nurses came out of a patient's room looking a little spooked. The charge nurse asked her what was up, and she said that the patient she was just with commented on the pretty little girl in the chair in his room and kept staring in that direction while she was doing his care. The charge nurse then told us that, many years ago, there had been a young girl who passed away in that room. I can't remember the full story, like why there was a child patient on the floor. Maybe it used to be a pediatric unit, I'm not sure. I haven't been at the hospital very long. But apparently every now and then the patients in that room make comments about seeing a young girl. Maybe she was messing with us, but another nurse at the nursing station said she'd had a patient mention it as well. I thought it was pretty spooky. I work in Gore, General Operating Theater, and one theater, Theater 7, was known to be cursed. It started with lights in the room flickering and equipment malfunctioning. When the electrician and biomedical technicians came to check on the equipment, they couldn't find any reason why they wouldn't be working. Then we had an unexpected death from a relatively simple case, which is extremely unlikely for our hospital. Then the next week, another patient stirred, woke early from a case, and started mumbling some incomprehensible words before going into a cardiac arrest. The week after we had another death followed by more flickering lights. This was when they got a priest in to exorcise the room, which, to be honest, freaked everyone out more. But the unsettling thing is that after the priest exorcised the room, we had no more deaths, no more malfunctioning equipment, no more flickering lights. I worked in a hospital in France when this happened, and this is the story that made me believe that there were things we couldn't explain. It wasn't too far from where there were trenches from World War I. It was common to hear people shouting in French orders to fire or see people dressed in World War I attire, but this scared me to the core. One night, a man recovering from surgery started shouting in Spanish that we needed to get the soldier out of his room. Whenever anyone would come to see what was going on, the soldier wouldn't be there, and he'd be insisting that he'd seen a boy no older than 18. This happened throughout the night and apparently didn't end until he was discharged that day. It was creepy. We also had someone who passed away from old age haunt the room she was in for a few days until she left. No one's seen her since. I'm a third-year nursing student. I worked in a theater. It's cold and huge. Normally, everything is ready before the surgery, but sometimes we need to run over to get tools or medications. Anyway, the theaters are divided by the type of surgery, so orthopedics has its own section, urology, and gynecology in these huge open spaces separated by doors. The lights get turned off, and it's pitch black. I could almost feel my pupils fully dilating when I walked from one section to the next, only being guided by exit signs. The instruments would be packed properly because they're sharp and need to stay sterile. However, every few days or hours, we'd find them strewn all over the floor, like someone picked them up and threw them all over. Also, bed bells are lighting up. The staff would get fed up by the clicking sound of someone wanting attention, then they would go to the room, completely empty, and tell the person to leave, then it would stop. In May 2000, I started my nurse training and moved into an old hospital building that was formerly used as the morgue. I didn't know this until I moved out. The building was really creepy, and we all joked it was something out of the ordinary. It had long, dark corridors, cold spots, and a constant feeling that you were being watched. Despite the creepy feeling, I never experienced anything spooky for a while, mainly because I was working or socializing so much. 6 months in, I was having trouble sleeping one night because my room was so hot. I finally got to sleep but woke up about 2 a.m. because I felt icy cold. I covered myself up but had a terrible feeling of dread. I tried to push the sensation away, but after a minute, I felt like I was being held down by something ice cold. I was terrified but was too scared to look. The sensation of being held down lasted a minute and went away. The room suddenly became really hot again, and the feeling of dread disappeared. After a few minutes, the sensation came back even stronger, and I was pinned down again by something ice cold. When it lifted, I ran out of bed and switched the light on, which stayed on for the rest of the night. Nothing happened in that room again. I actually moved dorms after this, and nothing happened for a while. Sadly, I was asked to go back to the east side of the building while building work was carried out in my dorm. I subsequently experienced worse things, mainly knocking and scratching sounds in the early hours, the feeling of something jumping off my bed, and also waking up to something scratching my back. I confided in my other housemates, who were equally terrified and experiencing similar things. A few people even reported waking up to see a young girl in their rooms. We all got so worked up that we all slept in the same room for months. I eventually left to complete my final placement and was so relieved to see the back of that place. There's a paramedic I work with who is a real straight shooter, no BS kind of person. I don't consider myself susceptible to people's war stories at work since there's sometimes exaggeration involved. But I was 100% inclined to believe her when it comes to these kinds of things. On a call for a cardiac arrest, she walks into a house, and it appears that she's talking to herself. Before she even got a rundown from the fire department crew that was there first, she had no other way of knowing and being able to say the patient's name. She was apparently communicating with his spirit, who was watching from the entryway to the room. It was the guy who was dead on the ground. She claimed to see the spirit of the recently deceased, and he was saying that working the code would be a futile attempt, and it was his time to go. She had no previous knowledge of the patient but somehow knew his name. She's got other paranormal stories, and I believe those, too, but this is the one that stuck out to me. I think the term might be medium? Kinda creepy. Former CMA. I worked at a nursing home on the night shift. I had a coworker who said she was a Wiccan. Not too far-fetched, but she also claimed to see demons in our nursing home. I didn't believe that, but there had already been a few freaky things happening in our center. Knocking on the door and setting off the outdoor motion detectors with no one on the camera monitor, that kind of thing. I'm still not sure ghosts are real, but whenever I think back on this experience, I'm in disbelief about what actually happened. I was on duty alone one night in our Alzheimer's unit. I started hearing some footsteps and the electric sound of a room door opening. They were all handicap accessible. Our nurse's station was a semicircle completely windowed, so I could look around pretty easily and see about half of the residents' rooms and the living room. No one was there, so I went out and individually checked on each resident to see if they got out of bed. No one did. I went back to my station. I started hearing it again, and it was starting to seriously freak me out. I checked on the residents one more time before video calling my friend from Australia. I was almost in tears because the sound was so clear. I started hearing children's music faintly. It was like a horror movie. Then I looked to my left and saw one of the residents staring at me through the window. It clearly scared the daylights out of me. She looked angry. She pounded her hand on the glass. I hung up the call and went out to help her. Now this resident is a stroke survivor. You could usually get a general idea of what she wanted, but she was muttering angrily pure gibberish. I asked her questions, trying to see what she needed, but she just got more frustrated. I brought her to her room, gave her her medication, because it was right around time for it anyway, and she went to sleep. She would die from another stroke in 2 days. I start cleaning the building. The spa room, for some reason, always gave me the creeps. This time, I could not clean it at all. The spa room is in a sort of uppercase I shape. The front area is where you get the supplies, residents can undress, etc. There's a small hall with a shower to your right and a hot tub to your left. The end has a bathroom. In the left corner, there is always a chair. This night, the chair was in the middle of the hall, facing the door. There was no reason for it to be there. If a CMA was helping a resident into the bath, it would have been further back, as that location has no range of motion. If it was to help a resident get undressed, it would be further up. I noped the fuck out of there. And here's the kicker. Some backstory, one of our Alzheimer's residents was living with her non-Alzheimer's husband in the same room. She often forgot who he was, and it was very sad. The week before this, he tragically died in the hospital. The next shift, I was on an evening night double shift, the morning shift girl told me something strange. She said that about 30 minutes after I left, the woman ran out of her room screaming. She told her, "There's a man at the end of my bed saying he's dead." Years ago, I had a second job as a security guard. One of our sites was a building that had started out as a hospital. The city and hospital worked out a deal, a new hospital building in another part of town, and the city gets the old building. The city used the old building as a school, then offices, and it was sitting idle at the time, waiting for another remodel. Even when it was a hospital, there were stories about people hearing babies crying when no babies were there. When it became an office building, the stories were just folklore. How could you tell whether someone had an upset baby on another floor or not? We weren't the first company to patrol the site. We ended up losing the contract for the same reason. We couldn't keep a guard on the site. Most would work a week or so, then refuse to go back. Push come to shove, they would quit. Minimum wage only fights the willies so long. Most complained about having to chase noises all night. Hearing things that might be someone on another floor of the building. After a while, just give up on the upper floors and watch the halls on the first floor. But a few also mentioned hearing babies crying on the third floor. All the way up to opening the stairway door on the third floor, then finding nothing. I never worked the site. I was committed to a site that required some site-specific training, so we were always shorthanded there. The owner of the company covered a couple of shifts early on, then refused to go back. I'm pretty sure I would have walked before I went. I'm currently working as a nurse in a medical ward, and we usually hand out the patients' dinners on evening shifts. Bear in mind that I've never had any paranormal experiences, I don't have bad eyesight, and I'm pretty good at paying attention to detail. So while my colleague and I were handing out dinner, we arrived at a four-bed room, and I handed out a lady patient's dinner, helping her with the meal setup. At this time, I noticed that there was also another patient diagonally across her who did not have a meal. I smiled at her and thought that she must have been recently admitted, as I had never seen her in the ward before. She had short brown hair and was sitting up on her bed. My colleague insisted that there was only one dinner for one patient in that room, so I tried to see if there were any spare meals after we finished handing out everyone's dinner. I eventually managed to find a spare meal and prepared this for the suspected newly admitted patient. I rushed back to the room again to apologize for the delay, but to my surprise, there was no one in the bed spaced diagonally across the patient in the room. There were no traces of patient's belongings or even used linen that I swear I saw beforehand. I know for sure I saw the brown-haired lady there because I remember smiling at her, acknowledging her, and feeling bad that there wasn't dinner readily available. I suddenly got chills and questioned my sanity the whole shift, But everything was so vivid, and it was only my second day back at work after 4 days off. I didn't feel scared or anything, I was more flabbergasted than anything. The lady I saw had a good vibe about her. Working for the last 3 years in an old community hospital has made for an abundance of strange happenings. Especially in the older wings that are no longer used. Our old, retired CCU was because it's currently being used as a quarantine unit for C-19, notorious for telemetry monitors and call lights turning on without cause during the night. I've witnessed people walking in and out of rooms in our old observation unit when going up to scavenge for four pumps and the like. Creepiest thing, though? One I'll probably never forget. I helped give an old, demented woman a bed bath one night. She was very much alive and very much talking or complaining to us through the whole thing. 10 minutes later, we hear her scream down the hall, "Help! Help me! I'm dying!" We got to the room and found her completely pulseless and apneic. Eyes and mouth hanging open like she had witnessed something horrific just before she passed. It still creeps me out, to be honest. Working in an ER, I've witnessed a lot of deaths. But, man, that one got to me. It makes me wonder what she saw just before she died. I've worked at home health and nursing homes. The scariest thing was one of my clients with dementia. I grew so close with the family that the client would make comments that his wife needed to get new wallpaper because it was covered with spiders, and he always saw spiders dancing on her head. I would spend casual respite time, i.e., playing games or watching TV with the couple, socializing with their family as they would come and go from the house. Well, one family member was telling us about a dream he had. He didn't know who this man was in his dream, he had never seen him in his life. He just knew that this person was trying to harm him, and he had to kill him before this man could do anything. He felt so close to this person, like he had known him his whole life but didn't know who he was. Always in his dream, he saw him walking up and down the road or around town, and he would stare at him as he drove by. Sometimes he would make the conscious effort to stop and help him, but this man would attack him. Hearing all this, I was shook and immediately had it pieced together. I excused myself to cry the hardest cry since I lost my own mother years prior. I told him in confidence that this man he is seeing is dead. But he's in the form of his great-grandfather. Death is coming for his great-grandfather, and you feel the need to kill death before he touches your pop. The entire family later confirmed the angel of death when they're the only visitors in the house late in the evening. You only see a face for a split second, and then it's gone. It's one of the most unnerving things I've experienced. I'm a chaplain who has worked in hospice. Near-death awareness is a known and accepted phenomenon in the hospice community. The dying will begin talking to loved ones who have died, talking about seeing different animals, sometimes old pets, and some will even talk about seeing death or an angel of death. The one most interesting to me was a patient I worked with for a few months, from the time he was in oncology to his decline to death. He was open spiritually but had no religion. We held conversations about many spiritual things, so he was comfortable talking to me as he neared the end. One day, he waited for his family and the nurse to leave and then called me back into his room. He said to me, "I don't want to scare anyone else, and I don't want them to think I'm crazy. I can see death. I can see her out in the parking lot. She isn't ugly. My brother is with her." It should be noted that he had bone cancer located in his pelvis, which eroded it so badly that eventually an artery would burst and they wouldn't be able to stop bleeding. He was on strong pain medications but had nothing wrong with his brain and was entirely lucid. He talked about his family, his concerns for them, and what he was leaving behind. A few days later, he called me into the room. He told me that death was now in the corner, and she was calling him. He confessed he hadn't talked to his brother for years before he died, but he was so happy to see his brother with death calling to him. He asked me to pray for him in my own religion, Christianity, because he did not know how to pray before he died. He died that night. I have had numerous other experiences with death awareness, but this one has always stuck out to me. I'm open to interpreting it as the dying psychologically preparing for death. My job is to help them reach as much peace as possible before death, and if this is just psychological, so be it. I know he and others have died well. I majored in psychology and did my social service in the mental health department of one of the most accomplished traumatology hospitals in my city. So let me give you some context. When I joined the team, the chief psychiatrist and chief psychologist were in the middle of implementing several support programs for the relatives of hospitalized patients who had just gotten admitted. All this happened in the ICU group, so you may imagine the cases. This was a trauma hospital after all: hideous car crashes, terrible burns, falling from the ceiling, suicide attempts, explosions, and shit. Every meeting was really intense and made me reconsider my aptitude for containment. I should have picked a less emotionally draining job. Now the spoops. One day, two elderly ladies showed up for the large group session, and they were really sweet and kind. It was amazing how caring, comforting, and insightful they were when interacting with the other attendants, lifting their moods and saying what seemed to be just the right things to say. It blew my mind, to be honest. It was a great session. Then things got fucky. After every group session, if anyone wanted some one-on-one time, we obliged, of course, but since people couldn't stay in the meeting room waiting for their turns and couldn't roam the floors freely, we had a ticket system. We took the bed/room number and a name, and after reporting to our bosses, we went to deliver each ticket with which they could pass security and go up into the office. These charming ladies requested one. I even remember they asked for my pen to sign their names on my little roll call list, and I forgot to retrieve that one blue fountain pen the psychiatrist had gifted me. So me and my colleague dismissed the group, cleaned up the meeting room, and went back to the office to get everything we needed. The discussion was hot about these sweet ladies and their mad emotional caretaking skills, which made us pretentious college graduates look like amateurs. We got our tickets signed by the bosses and went to each bed, which requested one to schedule the sessions. Until we noticed a ticket that had no name on it, just the bed number. This was unbelievably wrong on so many levels. See, the heads of the department were really strict when signing things. We asked them to sign because these were their projects, and we were the young and passionate elbow grease. If we missed a number, we had to get it no matter what. If we missed a last name, we had to get it no matter what. What would never happen was for the doctor to sign something with a blank space. But this ticket had her signature. We backtracked to my list and got our tits in a knot because the list, the one they needed my pen to sign, also had nothing but the fucking bed number on it. And of course, the ICU bed was empty. We wouldn't ask because at the hospital we were students and the information was confidential. But bear in mind that the group invitation is made by social workers when a patient is admitted and the situation is critical. Not when they get a room once they stabilize. Not when they are discharged. And my pen showed up in the office. It's not the scariest story, but I wept that day. We did ask the doctors for advice because we had a wild day out of that situation, and they both suggested ghosts, lol. Back when I was an aide, I worked in an assisted living facility, and there was a single room in the back hall on the second floor where whoever was living in that room would complain of two young kids, a boy and a girl, who would refuse to leave. Typically, within the next month or so, the residents' mental health would decline, and they would pass away. As far as I know, nobody ever told the person living in that room that it was haunted. Randomly, one day they'd just put on their call button to get the kids out, who were waiting for a party every time, or they would ask us while we were already in the room to get the kids out. Since I've been a nurse, the weirdest thing that has happened is that a resident has passed away, and she was one who would play games with the staff when she was alive, such as playing a possum. After she passed, the call light in her old room randomly went off, and we could not shut it off. Nobody had filled her room yet. One of the aides told her to knock it off. The call light shut off, and we didn't have that problem again. This happened on Friday, April 10, 2020. I work at a doctor's office, and we always joke around about how the place is haunted because someone died there, and I'm normally the early guy on Mondays, Thursdays, and Fridays. All the lights are supposed to be turned on by me in the morning that go through the main hallways and the front desk area. What's not supposed to be on are the doctor's area's lights or the lights for the lab. Now I and one other person normally have the early shift of 6:30 a.m. to 3:30 p.m. I normally get there at around 6:15. Well, I did get there early, and half the lights were on. I turned off the doctor's area lights and the lab lights and continued on, knowing that I was the first person in the clinic. We do not have sensors for lights or anything else. My coworker comes in through the back, same way I did, and says all the lights that I turned off were turned on again. We check the cameras, and the cameras are rather high quality, and we do see some of the light switches depending on what camera you're looking through. We see the switches flip. And I came to find out that when I got to the front desk, our manager's door was halfway open. I never saw anybody else's car, and I know our manager was out for Friday, and I know for certain I was the only person in the office because I had to turn off the alarm. I tell my coworkers to close all doors and turn off all lights. When I worked in the hospital, I picked up a swing shift that ended up going long, so I was there until 2 a.m. I had a patient that was troubled all day talking about dying and writing illegible things on scraps of paper. Later in the evening, she was super calm and told me she was going to die. I talked to her the same as before, but this time she said, "No, I'm going to die." I walked out of her room, but about 10 minutes later, I had this feeling I needed to go back. I found her unresponsive with an incredibly weak pulse. I called a code. She was generally healthy and in her early 60s. After CPR, she was stabilized and moved to the ICU. My shift ended another 6 hours later. When I was leaving, the halls were empty, the lights were dimmed, and everything was eerie quiet. I had almost reached the exit door when I looked to my left up past the one-way glass, but there was a light behind it so you could see through. When I looked up, I saw that patient standing there, giving me this shit-eating grin. That room was locked for the evening, so there was no way someone could get in there. I thought I imagined it, maybe something was there and my mind made it up? When I went in the next day and everything was bustling again, I looked where I had seen her face, and there was absolutely nothing there that could even be mistaken. It was a blank wall. One of my dad's co-workers told him this story. He received an alert that a patient was in critical condition, so he was walking through an underground bypass that connects the two sides of the hospital to get to the patient. It was a very old hospital. I think it was the Glasgow Western Infirmary, and it has been demolished since. When he was walking through, he was met by a man who asked him which way was the way out. The nurse was confused since it was a straight tunnel, but she showed him the way out anyway. When he got to the patient's bed, the patient had already sadly passed away, but the nurse recognized the man. He was the man he met in the bypass corridor. When the nurse went to the CCTV to see if it was him he was talking to, the camera showed the nurse stopping and talking to himself. Ugh, I hate this because I don't want to believe in ghosts, but my mom has worked as a receptionist at a clinic for decades and sometimes stays for the late night shift to close out. There would only be a few other people there during closeout, namely any other receptionists, security, or custodial staff. So there are like four people in the building. My mom has multiple stories, but the one that comes to mind is when she had to run up to the third floor to get some paperwork from an office. While up there, all the lights are off, and she has to turn them on to get to the office. Then, she hears footsteps, not her own, down the hall, so she calls out, "Hello? Who's there?" To get a response, she doesn't think anything of it, gets the paperwork, and heads back downstairs. My mom asked if any of them had gone upstairs, to which the senior receptionist replied with concern, "No, we didn't. You didn't go to the third floor by yourself, did you?" Apparently, there was already a rumor that the third floor was haunted, which my mom had not heard of until that night. The other staff members swore they didn't go upstairs, and this clinic doesn't have patients overnight. So who knows? My mom believes in ghosts, but I'm sincerely hoping it was a prank by the security staff or something. In medical school, we had an anatomy exam on November 1st or 2nd. So on Halloween night, me and my roommate decided that since everyone else was off partying, this would be a good time to get some uninterrupted studying going. Well, it was already creepy as hell to be in the basement of the medical school, surrounded by cadavers. Well, an hour or so in, we're going through anatomy, and all of a sudden, on the other side of the lab, a faucet suddenly turns on. These faucets are the ones that have motion sensors on them, and we're all the way on the other side of the lab. We were a bit creeped out, but dismissed it. We get back to work, and then it happens again, but on a different side of the room, again far from where we are. This happens maybe two more times over the course of an hour or so. Finally, we've had enough, and we decide to leave. As we're gathering our stuff and heading out, we remark to each other about a side room where the instructors will prep their lectures and exams, etc. We decide to pop our heads in to see what is in there, and we stop dead in our tracks. Like I said, we were the only ones in the lab, and we had heard no one else come in. In the side room, there is some person that we don't really recognize bent over, working on a cadaver. Their back is to the door, and me and my friend were being plenty loud, but yet they remain hunched over, working on the dead body. We have no idea who this strange person is, and we've had it now. We slowly back out and get the fuck out of there. When I was in a rural practice late at night, I was checking on a patient inside the office with a closed door, naturally. All of a sudden, I heard a thump sound from outside where the nurse's desk was, which was about 5 feet from my door. Nothing strange, really, because the outside door was open for ventilation purposes. We were at 32 degrees Celsius, and maybe someone passed on the road or something. Whatever. The next day, a surveyor for another government agency stopped by, and we chatted for a couple of minutes. "I see you work a lot here. We passed by last night, and we saw the door open and a person sitting by the desk." I froze because, at no point during the night, there was someone sitting there. "Maybe you mistook the file cabinet, or whatever," I was trying to make sense of it. "No, no. It was right here, and when we passed, that door, the office one, was closed. We thought you were with a patient, and another was waiting." Creeped out as I was, I dismissed it. That night, after turning everything off, I went to my room to sleep. We have to stay in our practices during social services. We practically live there, and for the first half of the night I heard thumping outside and chairs moving slightly. Fuck me, I had to stay there for another 6 months. I work in a convent that's almost 100 years old. Someone has died in just about every room in the building, including the dining area. One night, when I was on night shift, me and only one other staff member in a four-story building, I was doing rounds when I heard a little bell tinkle. Like the ones you ring to hail the butler sort of thing. I look at my partner and go, "What was that?" But she didn't hear anything, so I figured I was just tired. We get back to work for 10 seconds when I hear it again, and this time my partner looks at me and goes, "I hear it." We checked all the rooms, 30 rooms on that floor, and all the sisters were fast asleep. There's no other staff in the building. We shrug it off, admittedly a little spooked. Then my partner, who has worked at the convent for 20-ish years, recalls that there was a sister in that hallway who used to call for help with a small handheld bell because she didn't understand the call bell system. She passed well before I started to work there 3 years ago, so I had no knowledge of this sister. But when you work in an old building with nuns, there's bound to be some spooky stories, right? This happened to my mom while she was working the night shift at a nursing college ICU. There was this female patient who was very serious, and doctors said she wouldn't make it through the night. It was around 2 a.m. when my mom and her colleague were at their nurse's station, which is in the adjacent room to the ICU, and suddenly they could hear heavy footsteps. As the footsteps came closer, they saw a uniformed army man, complete with clean-shaved medals and a hat under his left arm, walking past the doorway towards the ICU. As it was a restricted area and way past visitor time, they rushed towards the ICU to stop the army man, but as soon as they entered, he was nowhere to be found. While they were talking to each other about it, the lady who was critical started to flatline. They couldn't save her, and she was declared dead. After things settled while they were asking for close relatives like husbands or children, they only learned that her husband was an army man and passed away a year ago. The soldier who my mom and her colleague saw was this lady's husband, which they confirmed from a picture and a few other employees. He had come to take his beloved wife with him. My aunt used to work as a nurse on a palliative care ward in a hospital. She always used to tell us this story about several strange things that used to happen when she worked night shifts. She worked the night shift with two other nurses on the left wing of the ward. The wing was made up of two sections with eight beds in each. They had eight patients in room one that evening. The nurses had looked after one particular gentleman for a while. He didn't often get many visitors as his wife had died years earlier, and he'd lost touch with his daughter, so they quite often kept him company. He always used to ask the nurse to leave a light on by his bed so he could read if he couldn't get to sleep or for the TV to be left on low. Apparently he liked the voices in the background, and it comforted him knowing someone was there. For these reasons, they moved him into empty room 2 when they came into work around 9 p.m. so the noise and light wouldn't bother the other patients. This became a little routine when the second room was empty. My auntie and the two nurses started their shift as usual one evening and sadly discovered that the gentleman had passed away earlier that afternoon. Room 2 was now empty again, with the seven other patients in room 1. It was 11 p.m., all the patients were asleep, and the only lights on were those illuminating the office section where the nurses were sitting, along with computer monitors and the ceiling lights at the end of the hallway leading to the next wing. They were taking their break, having a coffee, and chatting when one of them suddenly stopped talking and held her hand up. They listened, and they could hear someone talking nearby. At first, they assumed it was someone from the next wing walking past, but the talking remained a few minutes later. My auntie looked around the corner to see if there was anyone there, no one. She turned back around to go towards the desk and saw a light shimmering in room 2. She called the other nurses, and they went into the room. The bedside light was on, and the TV was on in the bay where the gentleman used to sleep. Auntie said they got the shivers, but it made them feel slightly emotional. However, they switched off the light and TV and went back to the desk. This apparently happened on seven other occasions over the following weeks, even when other nurses were working. Same light, same TV, always around 11 p.m. What my auntie said was so comforting, as she believed he enjoyed chatting with them and appreciated the extra effort they made to move him so he could watch the TV after hours, so he came back to see them again for their little ritual. The wards later filled up, and room 2 was being used more and more, so it was rarely left unoccupied. One patient mentioned a light turning on and waking him up around midnight once, but he couldn't recall which one as he went back to sleep. The legend lives on and is explained to new staff who work there. Everyone on the ward to this day knows of the gentleman who likes to watch TV late at night, and they are told that if the room is empty, to make sure the volume isn't high and to let him watch like he used to. We had a brain-dead cancer patient on our acute care inpatient hospital unit for over a year. She had deteriorated into brain death, and her family refused to face this truth, so they just stopped answering the phone or coming in. We had to work with the legal team to either get a DNR order or move her to a long-term care facility. The family then started fighting to keep her in our unit. Long story short, it took over a year for us to be able to take her off life support. She was alone, as her family refused to come be with her. After she passed, the monitor in her room would randomly change back to her name, even with a new patient in that room assigned to the monitor. Her cancer-ridden body had a distinct odor, which we would smell outside her room for weeks after she was gone. It was like she was stuck there in that room where she had been trapped or abandoned by her family. Awful situation all around. This was an odd experience. I'm a nurse in the PACU and was on call during a big-ass snowstorm. I didn't want to drive home and risk getting called back in, so I stayed at the hospital that night on our little couch in our break room. I dozed in and out throughout the night, but I got caught in some state between wakefulness and sleep, and I fucking swear to God, I felt this malevolent being in the room with me at one point. It was super dark, and I just felt angry about it. Like this unbridled hatred and rage. It was so heavy, it was palpable. It almost felt like it was jealous that I was alive. Anyway, it came down on top of me and pretty much collapsed through me, and I just heard it cry in seething anger. Then it was gone, and I was fully awake. I've had sleep paralysis from time to time, but this felt different. And I have never felt such hatred from anything I've come across in my life, real or conjured. The cliche part here is that this happened around 3 a.m. Hospital doctor in Colorado. I have three stories. Working overnights and getting a page that an old lady with dementia is flipping out. She says someone is in her room watching her around 2 a.m. We got this three or four times, and we decided to move her to a new room for other staffing issues. Move over an elderly man without cognitive impairment. 1 hour later, boom, same thing. Someone is in the room watching him, and the room is cold. I call bullshit and go check it out. I walk in, and the room is so goddamn cold that I can see my breath. I have this eerie feeling that something is watching me. Nope out, move the patient to a new room, and leave the room empty all night. Side note, I ran 6 codes over 3 years in that room and never got a single one back. The same hospital has a big burn unit. People flown in from around a 5-state radius. There was a Native American man who had had that room for several months. I don't remember how he got burned, but it was around 75% body surface area. Keep in mind that every single day they are washing these burns out and going to surgery every few days to debride. It's horrible and not something I want any part of. Anyway, this guy eventually dies after months of this torture. Shortly after, there were weird electrical things in there, which I personally witnessed. Lights off slash on. The TV suddenly turns on at full volume and won't turn off. Phone ringing and static on the other end. The RNs would literally walk in the room, say his name, and cut it out or stop. And, I kid you not, whatever it was would stop. Every single patient in that room for months after talked about seeing a Native American man. It got so bad that the hospital administrators legit called in a Native American shaman from his tribe to cleanse the room, had a ceremony, and everything. After that, it never happened again. This one creeps me out the most. I work at a different hospital, and the on-call room is an old, repurposed ICU room. The old hospital expanded, and they redid the old rooms. I'm in there asleep in the chair at 5 a.m. The nurses would sometimes pop their heads in the room, so I blocked it with a trash can and Harrison's Principles of Internal Medicine textbook, 5k pages. I'm drifting off to sleep when the door opens and someone walks in. It kind of looks like my partner, who is supposed to be relieving me, is 2 hours early. Strong feeling it's female for some reason. Anyways, it walks over to where I'm sleeping, leans over, and hisses in my ear, the worst goddamn sound I have ever heard. It sounded like an Aztec death whistle, shit's creepy. I didn't know it at the time but heard it later. I shake myself awake and am freaked out. Figure it's just a night terror, but realize the door is pushed all the way open and the books are holding it open. I never slept in there again. You may not believe me, but these things all happen to me. Hospitals are weird places. Almost everyone who works nights has a hospital ghost story, but they aren't likely to tell you because it makes them seem crazy. My aunt used to work as a labor and delivery nurse, and I remember her telling this story to my mom once. She was working a shift where the woman she was assisting in childbirth had lost her grandmother. They were not close and had never met, not long before her labor. In the middle of the frantic moaning and crying during delivery, the woman suddenly looked to a corner of the room, heaving and sweating. The only thing there was an empty chair. Nobody was there. She started talking to the corner, seeming to respond to questions, and generally just having a full-blown conversation with what seemed like herself. My aunt and the other nurses thought she was just delirious and tried to just soothe her through and ignore her. The woman's husband and her mother would try to calm her down and say, "There's no one there," but she would continue talking to the corner. When she was out of labor and they gave her the baby to hold, her mother and boyfriend were there, and she turned to her mom, smiled, and asked, "Did you hear her earlier? Is your new life everything you imagined it would be? An adventure?" The mother was shocked. Apparently, the mother was an immigrant from China and left her parents behind for a life in the US. The last words the grandmother had spoken to the mother directly were, "I hope your new life is everything you imagine it will be. An adventure." The grandmother died soon after. She had never met her granddaughter, and there's no way the woman would have known the words she said. I was at work after the dinner rush. I knew the story of the man in the tall black hat, I'd just never seen him personally. I was reporting to a nurse about my recommendation for a diet and swallowing precautions. I wanted a patient who was nearing the end of their life. We were discussing how the patient wouldn't likely make it more than a few days and had already been chattering to me about the small kids at the end of the bed and the tall man. I was facing the nurse with my back to the hall where I had just come from, and she was looking over my shoulder. I felt a tap on my shoulder and a glimpse of darkness out of the corner of my eye. The nurse just grinned at me as I whipped around, where I saw only an empty hallway. She said, "You just saw him too, didn't you?" The patient passed away 12 hours later. I have to be honest. It's not the tall man with the hat that freaks me out. Not the kids. Not the fact that the 100-year-old patients tend to congregate around the room of the next upcoming one to pass. Those are all informative and help me know when to call family in. The thing that freaks me out so much is the fact that they all see the same damn thing. Regardless of their health, reason for passing, illness, or whatever, if their march toward the end of life is slow enough to see it in stages, they all talk about the same things that they see. Family members long past calling out to them, the small kid standing unobtrusive at the edge of the room, in broad daylight, mind you, and the tall man with the hat. It's so consistent, you can almost set a clock by it. Ask any nurse. They are made of steel and iron, but they all know the signs the other patients give off when someone is about to pass. Source: speech-language pathologist specializing in swallowing in a SNF for 5 years. This is probably going to get buried. When I was a nursing student up on an ICU floor, I was hanging antibiotics in my patient's room when I heard an audible "Hey!" I turn around, and there is no one else in the room. Mind you, my patient was intubated and sedated, so there's no possible way it was them. It was a woman's voice as well, so I thought it was my preceptor. I went back out to the nurse's station, and I asked my preceptor if that was her in the room trying to catch my attention. She told me no, and I've never seen someone's eyes get so big. Apparently the room I was in had the most paranormal sitting and activity out of all the rooms on the unit. Sitting as in shadows in the corner of the room, voices being heard and curtains being flung violently across the railings. No one ever told me about this room prior to my preceptorship, so it just added to everyone's beliefs that it was haunted. I was working as an RN at LTC. There was a long-term, very elderly patient whose daughter was a regular visitor. She was extremely difficult, and none of the staff's efforts were good enough. According to people who knew her in the community, that was how she was with everyone everywhere. The daughter was diagnosed with terminal lung cancer and became a patient on the same floor as her mother. I had worked with people at the end of their lives dozens of times and was well versed in providing comfort care. No matter what medications we gave, emotional support was provided along with every holistic intervention we came up with. She was persistently agitated. When I asked her what was wrong, she said, "I know I'm going to hell. I've been an asshole to everyone. I'm going to hell." The look of fear on her face was like nothing I've seen before. We were able to manage her physical pain, but I don't know that we were ever able to manage her emotional distress. It was heartbreaking. Hi, this happened to me when I just started working as a therapist in a nursing home. I live in Argentina, and if you don't know, Argentina is a very religious country, Catholic or Christian for the most part, but I was raised in an Umbanda family. Umbanda is a pagan cult for some people. Anyway, the nursing home was an old house remodeled to be a good place for the elders that live there, plus a building of 7 stories known as the VIP since the wealthiest elders went there. The 7th floor is just deposit and offices. I heard from the nurses and security to never go alone to the office on the 7th floor of the VIP since it's haunted. Because of my beliefs, I do believe in this kind of thing, so I tried to never go alone, but one day I had to get some documents from that office, and I needed them ASAP, so I went alone. I was in the elevator, and for some reason it was cold. At the moment it was summer, so we had 35 to 38 degrees Celsius, but I ignored it. I make my way to the office, and when I'm there, I hear a clear voice saying to me, "You belong in hell, you filthy sinner." It was the voice of an old man. I never told anyone about my beliefs since it's something wrong for almost everyone I know, so I have no idea how he knew about it. One time I had a woman who had psychosis, related to her pregnancy irk, who had to be intubated and sedated in order to perform an emergency C-section. She remained intubated afterwards because she bled a lot and was on some medication to support her blood pressure, etc. She had to be very heavily sedated because she was totally wild, and all the psych meds she was on made her somewhat tolerant of our sedatives. Well, the nurse who had her thought she was sedated enough left her room. Within a few minutes, she got out of her restraints. We restrain almost all intubated patients, and ripped out all her IVs, her central line, arterial line, urinary catheter, and ETT, breathing tube. She stripped out of her gown, somehow tore out some of her stitches, and then walked naked into the hallway with blood gushing down her abdomen and legs, all while screaming and running around. Security had to come and gently get her back into bed, where we gave her a little sedation and, unfortunately, had to restrain her again because she was going to harm herself. That was scary. Our patient's vent started alarming. We went in, and there was a huge air leak in the vent system. We could not see anywhere with a leak, so we attempted to bag him, but it didn't work. You could literally hear the air leak from his ETT at that point. The man became very hypoxic, and he was already in terrible shape, so he started to code. While we were doing compressions, he was reintubated. We discovered that his ETT had been cut, very obviously. Unfortunately, the patient didn't survive the code. It was pretty clear that his family, who were the only people in the room with him, had cut his tube. Police, etc., were called. I don't know what ended up happening after that. Okay, so this wasn't when I was a nurse. I was working transport in the hospital, but I'm a nurse now, so I feel qualified to answer this. I got a call to take a patient to Sono. Keep in mind it's 2 a.m. and the patient I'm taking is dementia, pretty advanced, so I couldn't really make any conversation. Plus, Sono is down this long hallway away from the main part of the hospital. So while this patient is getting her ultrasound, it's just me, the patient, and the Sono tech. So me and the Sono tech are having a conversation about how creepy hospitals are at night, and I'm telling her about weird noises I hear that I assume are just the tube system. And I ask her about her end of the hospital since it's so secluded. And she says, yeah, sometimes people can hear a young girl laughing or a dog barking. But otherwise, nothing major. So about 15 to 20 minutes go by with nothing, the patient is sleeping, and then I hear it. The dog barks. And I look at the Sono tech, and she hears it too. Then the patient's eyes shoot wide open, and she starts to sit up, and she says, you have to let her out. Keep in mind that this girl has not formed a coherent sentence since I've seen her. So of course I did the obvious thing and said, what? And she goes, that little girl is in the corner. Is that your daughter? And then she starts mumming and goes back to sleep. The Sono tech cleaned up her stuff and noped it out, as did I, and we never spoke of it again. Nothing else has happened since, but I still wonder about that patient and how she's doing these days. We were on a night shift, standing or sitting around the nurse's station and talking about weird things that had happened. One of the HCAs was in a side room once doing last offices, and the lights flicked on and off twice. He called bells going off when there was no one about to press them. He heard a cough when there was no one there, etc. As we were talking, there was a pause in the conversation, and very clearly, we heard typing from the keyboard at the doctor's desk, which was just around the corner from us. I stepped around the corner to see who it was, as usually the doctors would check in with us before sitting down, just to say hello and to see if there were any jobs needing attention. So I looked around the corner after hearing the keys being tapped as if someone were typing, only to see no one there. It was very freaky, and we had to change the conversation as we all felt uncomfortable after that. We had a little boy come by ambulance who was a toddler. His parents had put him to bed, and he had a cold. Nothing serious, but he tragically developed more, and he started coming in and out of consciousness. We had to do a rapid intubation, and he ended up passing away a few days later. Before mom and dad made it to the hospital, he kept talking about his baby sister Hannah. Not soon after, we had to take life-saving measures. I was distraught because I had a son similar in age and a daughter named Hannah. Fast forward. Approximately 2 years later, the family comes in with a sick infant. They remembered me, I did once I recalled their story, and I was their provider again. Their daughter's name was Hannah. It startled me, and I recalled with clarity the boy speaking of his sister, whom I assumed was alive and at home. Nope, she wasn't even conceived yet. Baby, thankfully, went home with parents and is doing well, but I'll never forget that. The little boy and his baby sister, Hannah. I'm not in human medicine. I'm a licensed veterinary technician, but our emergency hospital is haunted by a gentleman we refer to as Gerald. The clinic was built for us, we didn't take over another business. We've all seen him, usually around 4 a.m., and sometimes we see him at the same time. Once, I'd taken radiographs of a patient with my coworker, and I thought my doctor had been standing outside the door but just walked away. I saw the figure walk away. I called out for the doctor since she'd just walked away, and my coworker laughed at me and said she was still in the office, it was just Gerald. He also meows like a cat from our comfort room sometimes. We have two clinic cats, and they're always with us and accounted for when we hear them. It's also obviously a person meowing when we hear it. We have cameras. Nobody is there when these things happen and are seen. He's just a part of the clinic. I am a psychiatrist, and during my training years, I worked for 6 months at a ward treating patients with depressive and anxiety disorders. It was an old building that had been housing psychiatric patients since the mid-1920s. On our floor, we had 13 beds, a nursing station, a living room, and a few conference rooms. One day, a few weeks ago, I was interviewing a patient who, when asked about sleeping patterns, told me she had heard a baby crying at night, waking her up. There are no babies in that hospital as the place is situated far away from housing areas, and there are restricted visiting hours. Afterwards, the nurse pulls me aside and tells me that the baby crying thing is not a psychotic symptom. She is very serious about this but won't elaborate. I kind of shrug it off, as either way it does not change the diagnostic or treatment, and I forget about the experience. Around 3 months into my stay, I sit in the nurse's station, and the three nurses behind me are talking. One of them says, "She is very active today," and the other says, "Really? Oh, hadn't noticed." I turn around and ask them who they are talking about. They look at each other, and then one of them hesitantly says, "Well, there is a baby here. She cries sometimes." I, of course, say no, but they just kind of shrug and smile. Not 30 seconds later, I hear it. It sounded far away, but not too far. A cry, clearly a baby cry, sounds like it is separated from us by maybe two or three walls. I am perplexed and look at the nurses. They look at me like I told you so. I of course ask about this, but they can't say anything else, but this faint baby cry is there and has been there always. Since then, I have heard it maybe two to three times a week. I told a new doctor about it who laughed. However, a few weeks into her stay, she came to me, white as a sheet, and told me she heard it during their coffee break. All the nurses are just kind of new about it, and being in psychiatry, hearing that kind of stuff is not really something you brag about. I was transferred and haven't heard it since. I think about it sometimes, but I don't really know what to make of it. My mom used to work as a night nurse in the burn unit at a hospital in Dallas, Texas. She told me that people would always talk about how the burn unit was apparently haunted. She wasn't really sure whether or not to believe this until a little girl came into the unit with horrific burns. The little girl did not always have her parents stay the night with her, so my mom would try to check up on her pretty often when she worked. One night, my mom asked the girl if she ever got scared at night. The little girl responded, "No. I don't get scared because an old woman comes to read to me every single night and sits beside my bed while I fall asleep." This shocked my mom because there were no older women working in the burn unit at night, and she would usually be the only person on duty during those times. It isn't that scary, but she always recalls it being one of the craziest things that has ever happened to a healthcare worker. Growing up, my maternal grandmother and I were always pretty sensitive to paranormal stuff, but my mother was not. She thought her mom was a crock, and she was sure I was making stuff up. Just as a preface. So while mom was in nursing school, she worked as a home health aide. She got a pretty cushy gig working with this disabled woman named Mary. I was too young to know what was wrong with Mary, but looking back now, I would guess she was someone who was mentally 5, though she was in her 50s. Mary's parents had provided well for her. They left her with her own giant, beautiful home, fully equipped for a handicapped person, enough money in a fund to finance care, etc. So mom was one of only 4 staff to work with Mary because she did not like new people, 2 midnighters and 2 day staff. She received around-the-clock care, but mom was able to bring Mary home with her, so we spent a lot of time with Mary as a family. Mary was sweet and very kind. I actually have an old photo of me, her, and mom when I was dressed for one of my dance parades. We all loved her to death. One morning, on a day when mom was off work but had school, she got up in a rush and ran downstairs. I thought she was late to school, so I went down with her to help her get what she needed to leave. But she was on the phone, dialing people who were not answering her. I will never ever forget this. Mom was shaking and crying, blubbering to herself without making any real sense. She finally slammed the phone down on the table and put her hands on her face, and I asked her what was wrong. She told me she had woken up to Mary at her bedside, patting her hand the way she did when she was very pleased with something Mom did, but when she sat up in bed, Mary was gone. The phone rang, and it was the nurse at the house. Mary had passed away the night before. She came to tell Mom goodbye. She still never believed in the paranormal, but she did quit nursing school and never worked in home health again. She never said, but I got the sense she couldn't handle another Mary happening to her again. My mom was pretty stoic, but that broke her. I worked as a medtech at an assisted living facility. One day, a resident, I'll call her Margaret, suddenly passed away, and her family left all her belongings in the room that night, including her pendant, to call the staff for help. The next night, Margaret's neighbor called the staff because someone was talking in the room next door and keeping them awake. We brushed the resident off, knowing that Margaret's room was empty. About an hour later, Margaret's pendant started going off from her empty apartment. I was the only one willing to go turn it off, so I walked into the room, and it was freezing cold in the middle of summer, the air conditioning was off. Suddenly, the bathroom door slammed as I was turning off the pendant light. I locked the door and ran back to the nursing station. We forced one of the older male staff members to go check out the entire room, and he claims the door was still locked when he got down there and no one was in there. I'm a nurse. I've witnessed quite a lot with elderly people. They often develop their own scenarios in their own heads, often accompanied by vivid hallucinations. Once during my night shift, I heard a woman scream in fear. Checking on her, she managed to climb into her wheelchair in pure panic, wanting to flee her bedroom. Asking what was wrong, she thought the building was on fire. Now, what's important to mention here is that people often make claims that people are just crazy or dreaming badly or something. But this is not the case. People with hallucinations have been found to actually see, hear, smell, etc. something when their hallucinations occur, as the same locations in the brain are stimulated as if they would get real impulses. That woman actually saw fire. She actually smelled fire. She didn't just make that up to be crazy. It's what her brain told her was happening. And she was in real panic for her life. And the same applies when those people see someone else in their room. When they want me to guide someone out of the bedroom who isn't actually there, seemingly standing right behind me, and it makes no sense to discuss with them that no one's there. To them, someone is there. And you better do your best effort of improvising to guide that someone, even if it's no one, outside. Play along, and they'll be fine. This, to me, is the scariest thing at work. They see something you don't. I'm a nurse. I've witnessed quite a lot with elderly people. They often develop their own scenarios in their own heads, often accompanied by vivid hallucinations. Once during my night shift, I heard a woman scream in fear. Checking on her, she managed to climb into her wheelchair in pure panic, wanting to flee her bedroom. Asking what was wrong, she thought the building was on fire. Now, what's important to mention here is that people often make claims that people are just crazy or dreaming badly or something. But this is not the case. People with hallucinations have been found to actually see, hear, smell, etc. something when their hallucinations occur, as the same locations in the brain are stimulated as if they would get real impulses. That woman actually saw fire. She actually smelled fire. She didn't just make that up to be crazy. It's what her brain told her was happening. And she was in real panic for her life. And the same applies when those people see someone else in their room. When they want me to guide someone out of the bedroom who isn't actually there, seemingly standing right behind me, and it makes no sense to discuss with them that no one's there. To them, someone is there. And you better do your best effort of improvising to guide that someone, even if it's no one, outside. Play along, and they'll be fine. This, to me, is the scariest thing at work. They see something you don't. Oh, I have so many, I don't know where to start. I worked in geriatrics, nursing homes, for years, so most of our patients died within a few years of being with us. Anyway, I had a new patient move into one of the rooms in my hall that my previous patient had just passed into. My new patient kept calling at night, saying that there was this woman who kept coming into her room and trying to talk to her. At first, I just passed it off on her being in her 90s and struggling with dementia, so I assured her that I would lock her door at night to make sure no one could come in. After about a week of this continuing to happen, I sat down with her and was asking what this woman looked like, thinking she may just be hallucinating her daughter or sister or something, and she proceeded to tell me that this woman had a pink robe on with blue fuzzy slippers and her hair up in curlers, and the women would come in, sit at the foot of her bed, pat the new patient's feet, and try to talk to her, but she couldn't understand what she was saying. I almost pissed myself. The patient that I had had in that room prior to my new one went to bed every night in her pink house robe, blue slippers, and her hair in curlers. It stopped after about 2 weeks. I worked in a pediatric hospital and had always heard that the fourth floor right outside our oncology unit was haunted. I worked 3/12s normally but would pick up overtime and pick up a night shift. I was working in the NICU, which happened to also be on the fourth floor but on the opposite side. The oncology unit had a staircase that was a short cut down to the cafeteria, which was on the second floor. At about 3 a.m., I was ready to take a short break and wanted a cup of coffee from the cafeteria, so I decided to take that staircase. I walked through the automatic double doors and saw a kid skipping down the hall. I called out to him, as I was afraid a little kid had snuck out of a patient room. As soon as I called out to him, he turned and, in the blink of an eye, totally vanished. A lot of other nurses and doctors had seen the same little kid skipping in that same hallway. Of course, I chalked it up to just exhaustion and didn't really think about it much after that. But you are damn sure I didn't use that hallway at night ever again. I'm a psychiatric nurse. Early in my career, I worked at a residential mental health facility. There was a resident I'll call Marion Duchesne. He was an elective mute, which simply means that he didn't, wouldn't, or couldn't talk, but there were no pathological findings as to why. He had spoken earlier in his life and, in fact, seemed quite normal back then, with the notable exception of being close to 7 feet tall. He'd been raised in the Deep South and joined the military when he was 19. After boot camp, he was stationed somewhere in the South. One night, he just vanished. He was declared an AWOL for years, and finally he was declared missing and dead. 10 years later, a 7-foot-tall man walked into a VA hospital emergency room in my part of the Midwest and said to the receptionist, "My name is Marion Duchesne, and I've been dead for 10 years." Those were the last words he ever spoke. He was covered with dust, and he was wearing the same clothes he'd been reported to be wearing the night he vanished. His social security number had not been used, and he had no identification on his person. However, they were able to identify him, I guess, via fingerprints. He was well-fed and in good health, except for his refusal to speak. The family was notified, but they said they had already grieved their lost man and that whoever was claiming to be him simply could not be. They said he was a haint and a stand-in for their dead relative and demanded not to be contacted again. Marion paced all day, every day. Not in a frantic way, but just lumbering up and down the halls and outside. He smiled all the time and would be moving his mouth in a way that indicated talking or muttering, but he was dead silent. He had an unnerving habit of throwing his head back with his mouth wide open as if he were laughing heartily, but not even a breath could be heard. If told to go to the dining room for a meal, he'd go and eat. But if nobody told him, he just kept pacing, never indicating hunger. If offered a cigarette, he'd smoke it in an oddly formal way, almost delicately, if that makes sense. But he never seemed to crave smoking. The man wanted nothing. If I talked to him, he appeared to listen, periodically throwing his head back in that laughter-mimicking way of his. There was nothing to do for this man. Various medications were tried, but they did not affect him either positively or negatively. Occupational therapy did nothing because Marion would just grin, and unless told to stay put, he'd get up and start pacing again. On my last day at that job, on my way to something better, the last thing I saw was Marion, pacing in the parking lot, throwing his head back to laugh. Later, I wondered if, all along, I'd been dealing with a ghost. All these years later, I still don't know.